So yesterday we saw about the static. How do we use static? How to call static member variables? How to call static methods? We saw static, how to provide input to a method, how to get return type, return from a method. Okay, these things we saw. Okay, so static, you have to remember that this is something which is connected to the class. Okay, and to use this from outside the class, you need to use the class name. So class name dot member variables, class name dot method, that is how you will be calling the method, and that is how you will be getting data from the variable. But object oriented programming is not always about the static. Okay, you need to create some objects and we need to create some instance to use the member variables. All right, so we'll see today how to create objects and how to use the objects. Okay, before that, we should know how to name a variable or how to name a class. So yesterday we saw a little bit about the naming convention. So naming convention, as I have said earlier, that we have camel cases. So Apex always uses camel cases to name any variable or class or method. So for class, we will use upper camel case. That means the first letter, it's not must. Okay, you can keep it small also. It will not give you any error. It's just the convention that we follow. So the class first name, first character should be uppercase, and then you can keep other small, and the next word that you're trying to next word that is there, so you can keep that the first character of that next word also uppercase. Okay, and that is how we name a class. So to name a variable and to name a method, it's same. So we are using the lower camel case. Okay, so first character can be small. Okay, first character can be small for both method as well as variable, and the next word's first character should be uppercase, so that you can distinguish that these two are different words. Okay, that is what is the convention that you use to name a variable or a class or a method. Okay, but there are certain rules that you have to follow in order to name a variable. Or see, this naming, all these things that we are naming, those are called literals. So the variable names, class names, method names, those are called literals. And the other, the words that are reserved, those are called keywords. So string, boolean, integer, those things are keywords. Static, public, class, these things are keywords that are reserved for a certain purpose. You cannot use it for anything else. Okay. So the only thing that we can name, those are called literals. Okay. So how to name a literal? Okay. So there is no special character allowed while naming a literal. The only special character which is allowed is underscore. All right. And so we have underscore. Then we have characters, A, B, C, D, all those things, alphabets. And then we have numbers. So these are the only three things that you can use to name a literal. So you guys got what is literal? Yeah?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. So any variable that you name, that cannot, the name cannot start with underscore. Okay. After the first character, you can use underscore anywhere, but the first character cannot start with underscore. Okay. And the, okay, let's try to use it in here. Let's demonstrate and that we'll see. Okay, let us say I try to create an integer. So integer, let's say I try to create underscore int. Okay, and then I say equals to 10 or 19, whatever. Okay, then I execute this. Let's see what happens. Okay, so invalid type, spelling mistake. One second. Integer, yes. Okay, so invalid character in the identifier, which is underscore. So you cannot write underscore in the beginning. Okay. So we cannot start with an underscore. So that is one thing. Okay. Now let us try to start with a number. With alphabets, though, for sure we can start with alphabets that we have already seen. Okay, so we can start with alphabets. Now let's try to start with a number. Let's say I have 10 int something. Okay, so let me execute this. So unexpected token 10. So with numbers also we cannot start. Okay. Okay, now let's start with some special characters. So this will also be not expected. So it is taking it as some kind of operator or some symbol. So these special characters are not allowed. The only special character which is allowed is underscore. Okay, and underscore cannot be in the beginning. Alright, so underscore cannot be in the beginning and underscore also cannot be in the end. It has to be somewhere in the middle. So underscore mostly in the literal is used to separate two different words. Okay, we can use int number, something like this. We can use like this. So int number, this will execute fine. Okay, this will not throw us any error. So the error that it can throw, that is a syntax error only. So it can only throw a syntax error. Okay, so this in the middle, we can write underscore. But let's try to end it with an underscore. So when we execute this, this will again throw an error. Underscore is not allowed in the end. So there is a simple logic behind this, why underscore is not allowed in the end, because most of the custom things that we use, like custom class names and custom object names or custom field names, all of them will be ended with underscore underscore C. Okay, if you see all the fields and all, if you go to the fields and then let's say we go to this opportunities and we go to the fields. Okay, if you see the API names of all the custom things, so all the custom fields, they end with underscore underscore C. And if you go to any custom objects, their object API name also will be ended with underscore underscore C. So maybe that could be one of the reason why underscore is not allowed in the end also. Okay, so you cannot end any literal with underscore. Okay, so underscore is only allowed somewhere in the middle, that we have already seen that it will execute fine. Okay, so that also we have to note it, that so cannot end with number underscore. Okay, but it can end with a number. If you say here, let's say 12, some number you have given. Okay, this is fine. Okay, so it can end with a number. This did not give us any syntax error, so this is okay. Okay, so can end with number or numbers, both, that is fine. Okay, so the only in the few things that you have to remember while naming it, where did that go? So it cannot start with an underscore, it cannot start with a number, it must start with a alphabet. Okay, so literal, it must start with alphabet. Okay, and then in the middle anywhere you can write underscore, and in the end you can write numbers or alphabets, that is fine. You cannot end it with underscore. So underscore can only come in the middle somewhere, and numbers can be anywhere apart from the first character. Okay, is this clear? Of these things. Okay, so that is how you name a variable or name a method, or this applies for everything, for class, for name, for variable. Okay, now let us see how do we create an object. Okay, before we do that, let's check out the structure. Okay, so when you create a class, okay, when you create a class like this, okay, let's say, so when you're creating a class, you're just creating a template. Okay, or you're creating like a frame or a blueprint, depending on that structure, you will be creating objects. Okay, so objects will be the actual entity which has the actual data. Okay, the class is just a template. The class is just a framework that you are trying to create, the frame that you are trying to create. So you are just declaring how many variables you will be creating. So like maybe in the top, you will be writing some variables. You will be creating some variables. Okay, so these might be my member variables. And in the lower side, we will be creating some methods. Okay, so this is the class, let's say. Okay. So we have created a class. So class is just a template that we have created, that these many variables will be there and these many methods will be there. So that I have defined while creating a class. Okay. And I might also create some static member variables. So that might also save some data. So excuse me. So with the class, the class only contains the static member variables. Okay. The class does not contain the object. Class does not know anything about the object members that you have created. So if you create an object of this class, so you will be creating just a replica of this. Okay, and that you can use to save data. Okay, as of now you forget about the static part. The static part, just you keep it aside as of now. So let's say we have created some non-static variables, like four non-static variables we have created, and three non-static member methods that we have created. Okay, so this is just an empty box or empty frame that we have created. This does not have anything. Okay, let's say if we have all these non-static variables and non-static member methods, so this is not of much purpose. Okay. So let's say I create one object of this class. So this is an OBJ. Let's say I created OBJ one. One object I have created. Okay. So one object that I have created, this object will be the actual container, and this object will be having its own copy of these member variables and these member methods. So it will have four variables that we have created and three methods that we have created. Okay, now we can access these variables and we can put data in these variables and we can use it, and we can also call these member methods. So how will we call? We will call using OBJ, the object that we have created. So like the static member methods and static member variables, how we used to call? We used to call using the class name. Okay, but here to use the member variables, which is a non-static, which is the object variables and object methods, those we will be calling using the object that we have created. Okay, so object is the actual thing which is created based on the frame or based on the structure that we have defined while creating a class. Okay, so let's say if I create one more object. Okay, if I create another object, Yes, definitely, definitely. The object name will always vary. Okay. The method name, once you define the structure of the class, that's it. It's defined. Now, for every object, you will not be creating different methods. So that is, I hope that answers your question. See, variable, once you create the methods that once you create, that we will be creating while creating the class. Okay, now object is created separately. So object is created using that class structure. So this object will have just the structure of that we have defined in the class. But each object that we define, they will have different copies of those member variables and member methods. They are separate. So once we have created object one, let's say obj one we have created, and then we have created obj two. So these object names must be different. And the naming convention, the same thing that we have to follow. Okay, so let us say out of this frame, I have created another object. So another object. So these variables that are there in this OBJ1, okay, they are their own copy. And these variables that we have, the variables are the same. It's just that they are different copies of the same structure that we have created. So in OBJ1, if I put some data, let's say this is an integer type. Okay, let's say this is an of integer type, and I have put some like 10 number here. Okay, so now this OBJ2, the int variable that this OBJ2 has, this also will be int only. Because where have we defined all these things, where whether it's in integer or string, that definition we have given here in the class. So it there's just one statement for using which we will be creating objects. So as soon as we create an object, one copy of the structure of the class will be given to us, and we can use that object to access the member methods and member variables using our object. Okay, so whenever we create an object, one copy of this framework has frame has created, and it has given to the OBJ1. So OBJ1 will be pointing to this structure. One copy it has given. Okay, so as we have defined integer here, so this variable will also be integer. This variable will also be integer. So if we put 10 inside this integer, OBJ1's integer, so OBJ2's integer will not have that value unless we access OBJ2 and we initialize that as some number 20. Okay, so the point I'm trying to make is that this box and this box, these two are different. They are not same. Okay, they are just the only common thing that they have is the common name. They will have common name. Both of them will have same name, and both of them will have same access specifier. Let's say if we say public stat, public or private, those things will also will be there, and they will also have same data type. If we say integer, if we, whatever we define inside our class, that will be these variables data type. Okay, but when we print obj1 dot this variable, let's say if this variable is named int, so obj1 dot int, this will print 10. Obj2 dot int, this will print 20. So how will the compiler distinguish these two? Using the name of the object. So in order to object this copy, in order to access this copy, I have to use obj1. In order to access this copy, I have to use obj2. Okay, is that clear? Any confusion so far?
Nope, it's fine.
Yeah.
That's
okay.
Fine.
Okay.
So, sorry, Mr. Mastan here.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So, it's related to static actually. So in which situation we need to go specifically for static variables and static methods? So that will be covered later, or how it is?
No, we can see that also. That see,
I have you study already covered regarding the static variables, static methods.
Yes.
So
yes.
I just
see, it's not like I have covered that topic, so it will not come. It's not like that. We have to like combine everything and use. So see, when the static will
no,
come.
I just wanted to know in which situation, in which scenario we need to go for static variables, and I had some confusion on that. So.
Okay.
Yeah, if possible, please. Yeah.
Yeah, we can see that also. Okay. So far, whatever we discussed, this is clear. Then we can move forward. Okay. So. Let's say these we have said that these are all non-static members. Okay, so the object will have non-static members copied in them. Okay, but when does the static comes into picture? So if we create an object, they will have separate copies. Okay, so let's say if I have some static members also. Okay, let's say I have some static members also. So if I have some static variables here. Okay, I have some static, four static variables, and I have some two static methods. Okay, so the static still applies. The static is still valid. So we can still access the static using the name of the class, just like how we used to access before. But the difference here is that each object has different copies, but the static is unique for every object. The static will not be created as a separate copy. Only the non-static will be created as a separate copy. So obj1 has the member variables which are all non-static. They are all separate copy exclusively for obj1. Similarly, exclusively for obj2. But this structure that we have, the non the static part that we have, that is same for everybody. So this same thing will be here also. This same thing will be here also. So obj1 also can access the static parts. The obj2 also can access the static parts. But this same copy will be shared for obj1 and obj2. So you cannot access the static parts using the object name, using the objects that you have created. You have to access them using the class name. Okay, so this is still the same for everyone. Okay. So when in which situation you will be using the static and which situation you will be using the non-static. Let's say I have a trigger. Okay, trigger is something that will fire when some account or some record gets created. It's just like a workflow rule. Okay, so as soon as we create an account, we have a trigger to be fired. So trigger is a part of code only. Okay, but all the logic is never allowed to write everything inside the same trigger. So what we do is we create separate methods, or we create a separate helper class. So in the helper class, we'll be creating small methods. Using that method, we'll be adding the logic in the trigger. So how will we access these methods? We will be accessing these using the static methods. So these methods that we'll be creating, these will be static, because we don't need to create an object every time we need to run a trigger. We can just call those methods using the class name. Okay, in that situation, you will be accessing using the class name, and you will be creating static methods that time. You won't be creating non-static methods. You won't be creating object methods. So if you create non-static methods, then you will have to create object every time you want to access that method.
In controllers also, we are using right, Sabha. So
in controllers,
controllers also will be using static variables and methods, right? So
it's not mandatory that you have to use that. It depends on the situation, actually. It depends on your requirement.
Yes, correct. It's not mandatory, but it depends on situation. So that situation, exactly how it is like that, I was asking.
Yeah.
So for triggers, I understand. So no need to create every time that object. So that is the reason directly if we mention static methods or static variables, directly we can access into helper class.
Yes.
But in controllers, in which situation we will be going for a static? If you want to store only particular data into statically, like in that situation only you'll be going for static variables, or how it is?
There are situations I got the question, but that is not the the other people that they are here, they won't be knowing about that because we have not covered that topic. But see, there are situations if you want to keep something unique, like you want to remove some kind of duplicacy, and for also to prevent recursions and all, we'll be using static parts. Okay, so if we keep for recursions, how you can avoid using the static variable is that the same static variable will be passed on to all the objects also. Okay, so but every time you create an object, a new instance is created. So you won't be getting the count, like what is the exclusive count for objects that you have created. So in order to avoid recursion and all, how many times the method is getting called and those type of things, you will be keeping a count inside the static variable, or the static variable will be used by all the objects. So you can keep a count of that recursion. So in those situations also, you will be using the static methods or static variables.
Okay, fine, thanks.
So these static members that we have, this same the static, it's not that obj1 has the is also having a copy of the static members. It's not like that. They can, from the non-static context also, you can access the static members. Okay, so let's say if I have a method, inside that method I have created one object. From the same method I can also access the static members of the class. Okay, how do we access the static members? I will be accessing using the static the class name. Okay, so you can use the class name, and then you can use dot, and then you can call the either the variable or you can call the methods. Okay, so if from the OBJ1 context, if we are trying to access this particular variable, and if we change the variable value, the same will happen for OBJ2 also. So once we have changed the value, the same value will be there for every object that we create. It's not separate. Okay, only in case of object, only in case of non-static variables or non-static members are copied into different objects that we have created. Okay, so that's the difference between object members and between the non-static the static members. So static members is same for all the objects, okay, but non-static are like separate copies. Okay, so let's see this in practice. Okay, before creating objects, okay, that we'll see later. Okay, so let's get into our developer console. So let me try to create a new class. So let's say maybe non-static demo. Okay, so I've created one class. So it's a public. So I don't have to do anything different to create any non-static members. All I have to do is I have to remove the static keyword. So if I remove static keyword from this line, it will become a non-static. So that means I have to access it using an object. Okay. So let me try to create some. I'll put some comments here. So I'll say non-static members, a member variables. Okay, so if I want to create some member variables, I have to do something like, maybe as of now we'll be using public, but this is not a good practice to use public because our data will be exposed to every other class. So the member variables are always kept as private, and the member methods are the one using which we will be accessing our data. So the methods are created as public and the variables are always created as private. Okay, but as we will be using these variables also to get the data and all, so I am keeping it as public. Okay, so if I create a variable, let's say a public integer, my int. Okay, and I have created. Now I need to create a method also. Let's say I'll create a public. I will create let's say void as of now, and then I can call my method. Okay, as of now it's not taking parameters. You guys know by now that if in case I have to provide any input to this method, I need to write it in the parameters. Okay, and if this method is going to give any output or return anything, that I have to write in the return statement here. Okay, I have to write some data type that it will be returning, that you guys know by now. Okay, so let's try to, I will do a system dot debug, and let's say value of my int equals to that my int. Okay, I've created a simple class. One variable is there, one method is there. Okay, as of now there's no value in this variable. So how will we be creating values in the variables is using the constructor. So now with object there comes a concept which is called constructor. Okay, so that we will see. Okay, and that we will, okay, that we'll see in the next step. Okay, let's say I've created one variable. I'll initialize it as of now. Okay, but this is not a good practice, that always the variables has to be initialized using constructors, that we'll see in the next step. Okay, let's say I've created one class, so which has one variable and it has one method. Both of them are non-static. That means I just have to remove the static keyword and it becomes an object variables. Okay, now how do I access this? So if I go to my anonymous window, and if I use something like let me just copy the name of the class. So if I call it using like this, non this dot my method. Oops. Okay, so non-static method cannot be referenced from the static context. Okay, so we have to, so this is a static context. We are using the class name to access, we have to use it only to access the static parts or the static members. Non-static cannot be accessed like that. For non-static, we must create an object. Okay, so how do we create an object? So we have to give the name of the class that we have, then we give the name of the variable that will be declared as an object. So which will be like an instance of the object. Okay, which will be pointing to the actual object, which will be pointing. So this obj1, this is the name of the object. So this obj1 is the one which will be pointing to this particular object. It will be somewhere in the memory. Okay, it will be somewhere in the heap. So this obj1 will have actually the location of that particular memory, so that it will be like pointing there. Okay, but as it's not readable by us, so it is created as a it's provided us as a variable. So we have to create one variable, let's say obj1. And the way you create any variable, that is how you will be creating these objects also. So this also cannot start with an underscore, or it cannot end with an underscore. Okay, and it cannot start with a number. That rule applies for this variables also, for this object variables also. Okay, all right, so we have created a variable for that also, and we give equals to, and then we use new keyword. So new keyword is the most important thing that we will be using, most important keyword that we will be using to create an object. Okay, so we will be using this. So it is equal to new, and then we give parenthesis. So this parenthesis is a part of the constructor. So this is a signature of the constructor actually. Okay, so constructor is like a method that we will be calling while creating an object. Okay, so which method? So if you see the calling statement of the method. So if we had a method here, we have a method here, print name. So how do we call the method name? How do we call print name? So we give the name of the class. We give the name of the class here, and then we say dot, and then we say print name. That is how we will be calling this static method, right? So if you see this thing from here to here, this is this call of the method, and this part is both same. Okay, but this in the, here we are not calling a method. Here we are actually calling a constructor. So constructor is like a method that we will be calling when we are creating an object. But in my class, I have not created any constructor like this. I have not created any method or anything which matches this signature. But how come it will still be calling? That is done because every time you create a class, the compiler or some member of the execution will be adding a constructor to our class, a default constructor. Okay, those things we will see in a bit. First, let's try to create a simple object. Okay, let me remove this. So I've created one object. Now using this object, now I can access my member variable. Okay, now you can access, let's say obj1 dot, I can call my method. Okay, now if I call, now this will be executing fine. Okay, so now my output is coming. So where is this coming from? This is coming from this particular member variable. Take care, that variable's value is come here. Okay, so similarly, I can create as many objects as I want, but all those objects will be like separate structure. Okay, so if I want to create another object, then all I have to do is I have to call using the, I have to call a constructor also, and then I have to use new keyword also, and then I can just change the name of the object. Okay, so using this object also, I can call my member variables. I can say something like obj2 dot my method. Okay, so that is how we will be creating an object. Okay, so the this structure that is there, so for obj1 it's separate, for obj2 it is separate. Okay, now if in case if I change the value of my obj2, so if I say obj2, change the value of the variable of the obj2, let's say if I say obj2 dot my int equals to, if I make it as, let's say 20. Okay, and then I do a debug, system dot debug. Okay, so what do I want to debug? I want to check out the values of obj1 dot myint and obj2 dot myint. I want to see whether the obj2 dot myint has changed and obj1 dot myint has changed or not. Okay, so I'll say maybe value, or simply say obj1 dot myint. And I'll say obj1 dot myint. Okay, same thing I'll do for obj2 dot myint also. So I'll say obj2 dot myint. Okay, just notice that we have changed the value of obj2.mynt, and I'm trying to check out both the values whether it's changing or not. Okay, so now if I execute the whole thing, let us see what happens. Okay, I'll go to the developer debug log. See, initially both the values here, initially both obj1 and obj2 were initialized, and I am calling this obj1 dot method. So when I call this obj1 dot method, so the first value is printed. So in obj1 dot method, what is there? It will just debug the, it will just print whatever is there in the myint. Okay, so it will just print that. So that is what is coming from when I call the first method here. So this is printing the first line. Okay, then it comes here the second line, then it creates another object, and then again it calls the my method using the obj2 reference. So when I create obj2, another copy is created and that is calling the method, and again the same statement is coming because I have just initialized. In every time I create a new object, it will be getting a value of 10. This variable will be getting a value of 10 because I have initialized in the beginning only. Okay, but later on if I change the value of any of the object members, so now if I do a debug log, in the end, see, both the values are different. I have changed value of what? I have changed value of obj2.myint equals to 20. But obj1.myint is also not changed. It is still 10. Okay, so what this means is that, this means that all the members of this obj1 and obj2 are different. They are like just copy. Myint will be available for all the objects that I create using this class. It will be available, the same structure will be available, the same number of variables, same number of methods will be available, but they are like separate copies for each of them, for each object. Okay, now let's bring in some static members. Okay, let's bring in some static variables. Okay, so if I create a static variable, so how do I create? I just say public and I say static and I say maybe string. Okay, and I give equals to, let's say I give my static variable. Okay, this is the value inside this. Okay. Okay. So some issue. So I have to give a name of the variable also, say my string. Okay, so let's say I have created this. Okay, so the static members I cannot access using obj1 or obj2. So let me try to access that using the obj1. Okay, so if I say, let's say obj1 dot my string. Okay, and let me execute this and let's see what happens. Okay, and the object variable, let me cut it here. So as I'm executing only these two lines, so only these two lines will be executed. Here we are creating just one object and we are calling the static member using the object. Let's see what happens. Okay, so static field cannot be referenced from a non-static context. Okay, the static field cannot be accessed from a non-static context. So using the object, we cannot call a static members. We have to use the class name. So as we are using the class name, it is common for obj1 also and obj2 also. There's no that will. So when we copy this, see, when we create a copy of my class in obj1, this thing will not be copied to that object. This will be still with the class only. So to access this, we have to use the class name only. Okay, so that means it is separate. Okay, so using the non-static context, that means using the objects, we cannot access the static members. The static members will be accessible in any static context or non-static context. Okay, what does that static context and non-static context mean is, let's say I create another method. Okay, if I say public static void my static method. So this is a static context. Why? Because this is a static member. It's a static method, but this is a non-static method. So from the static method, we cannot access the non-static members. So from this static, we cannot access the non-static member variables. I cannot access, let's say I can't say my int equals to 100. I can't say something like this. Okay, if I save this, okay, it's not letting me save and it is showing that variable does not exist. Okay, because the static member context will not be able to see the non-static parts. Okay, but from the non-static part, we can definitely access the static members. Yes. So why that happens? Because when we create a class, okay, when we create a class, as soon as we create a class, all the static members are loaded in the memory. Okay, so the static members are available. The first thing that will be loaded is the static members, not the non-static members. The non-static members is only loaded in the memory when we create an object. So that is why when the object is loaded, by that time, the class members are already there. That means the static members are already there. So from the non-static context, we can actually access the static members because it is already available in the memory. But when we create a static part, so static part is not aware of the objects, because the objects will be created later once the class is loaded and once everything is done. After that, the non-static parts will be loaded. Okay, so now if I try to access my static members from the non-static context, so this is my static context. So this is a static context and this is a non-static context. Okay, why it's a non-static context? Because I have not used a static keyword and it is a part of the object. So every time I create an object, that is when the method will come into picture. This method will come into picture. But to access this method, I don't need to create any object. Okay, all right. So let us try to access my static members from a non-static context. So how do I access that? I access that using the class name, but that is not required as I am inside the same class right now. Okay, so let us try to access my string. My string is static, so I'll just say my string equals to my value is changed from a non-static method. Okay, put a semicolon. Okay. What happened to this? There is no scroll bar. Okay, fine. Let me just save it. Thank you. Okay, so from my non-static member, non-static context, I'm trying to access the static method or the static member variable. So if I change this, so I have changed the variable or the change the value of the variable. Now let me try to do a debug log also, system.debug. Okay, let's say I say what value of my string equals to, say I give plus my string. Okay, let me save this code and I'll try to execute this. I'll try to call this method. If you see, it's allowing us to save. That means it is aware, the syntax, the compiler is aware of this my string from this method also. Okay, but we put the state, and this statement, if we put inside our this method here, this will be also valid. Okay, let me just once. So this is still valid. Here also we can change the value because this is a static context. So static context will definitely be aware of the static members. Okay. My int is a non. Okay. So my int is not available from the static context. So from the static context, we cannot access the non-static parts, but from the static context, we can only access the static parts. So if we say this statement, this we cannot, the first statement we cannot do, the second one we can still do. Okay, because my string is what? My string is static, and from the static methods we can always access this static members, but from the static context we cannot access the non-static methods or non-static variables. Okay, so let us try to call this method and let's see what happens. So if I try to call my method, I will be able to get the value of my int also and get the value of my string also. Okay, so if I go here, so I say obj1.my method. Okay, that is fine. So let me execute only this part. Okay. So if you see, I've just created one variable, I've created one object here, and using that object I'm trying to access my static method. So my method is a static method. This is I'm trying to access. So if, no, sorry, my bad. So my method is a non-static method, but from that non-static method I'm trying to access my static variables. Okay, which is my string. So my string is a static and we are still calling it from the non-static method, and the value is changed also here. So if you see, the value is coming as different. Okay, so to differentiate, let me try to call this before changing also. So I've changed it here. So I will call it here also. I'll do a system.debug. So if I call it here, so I'll say value of my string, or say I'll say value my string before change. Okay, let me try to execute it one more time. We can do that also, but it is not required here because right now we are in the same class. Okay, so yes, we can, from the non-static method we can also use the class name also, but that is not required because we are in the same class. So our members will be aware of which class it is calling from. So let's say if I call from my first demo class, if this class is trying to use this variable, then for that I need to call it using the class name.
Okay,
or if in case if I have a non-static context here, so if I want to access the variables for this first demo class, only the public variables will be accessible, and only if it's static.
Now in the same class, non-static members demo class, we have a static variable, right? Public static string my string.
Yes.
So if we want to call that in this non-static method, do we need to enter like
class name.
Class name dot my string?
We can do that. That is not any problem. This will not. This is still valid. It's not a error or something. This is still valid, but that is
okay.
not required. Why do you want to do that? Like, if you are able to access that without that, then why do you need to include the class name? Because
okay.
class name is used when we try to show from the compiler that this particular variable belongs to this class. But as of
okay.
now, we are yeah. So as of now, we are calling this method from the same object only. So it knows that this
okay.
Member belongs to that particular class.
Okay.
So this will be more clear when we see the order of execution, how the static members are loaded, how non-static members are loaded, when they are available. So when we see that we'll see in the next class. Okay. Then it will be more clear.
Okay.
Okay. So we can still do that. This is still a valid statement. So that is not an issue. Okay. Okay. So I have executed this. Huh. Okay, so if you see the value of the string before change is the initial value that we have defined, but later on after change, this value is changed. So that means from a non-static context or non-static methods, we can access and we can manipulate the static members also. Okay, why? Because when the non-static is created, when the object is created, that time the static members are already loaded into memory. So OBJ1 is fully aware of the static parts of the class also, the static members of the class also. Okay, but when the static members are loaded, that time object was not created because static members are loaded in the first. So as soon as the class is loaded, the first thing that will be loaded is the static members. And when the non-static will be loaded, so non-static members will be loaded when the object is created. Okay, so that's the difference between the static and non-static. So static is always attached to the class. As soon as you load the class or as soon as you create anything belongs to the class will be loaded and with that the static members will be loaded. But when you create an object, only that time the class, the non-static members will be loaded. Okay, so that's the difference. Okay, so we'll see more examples and we'll also see things like initialization block. So there are some things called static initialization block, non-static initialization block that might be helpful in some situations also. And we also have to see constructors. Okay, so today we just saw the objects and we have to see this and we also have to see constructors. And then we have to see initialization block also. So they are of static. Two types, static and non-static. Okay, and this all these things we'll be demonstrating next class. Okay, so for today, whatever we discussed, is that clear or you guys have any doubts, any questions?